Those are the winds of change blowing, folks. Faith No More is back, and we're here at Nostalgia Factor to talk about that and other things today. Like what?
Is it?
That's it?
It's it.
What is it?
We've taken a little bit of a hiatus, haven't we?
I would say from the podcast, yes. From doing other amazing and awesome things, no. I think we're both doing a lot of proactive things, so the hiatus has been well used, and now we're back, and we've got more ammo for your brain.
Yeah, so we recently took a trip to both Chicago and Detroit to see Faith No More, and we're also going to talk about Grand Theft Auto 5 a little bit on PlayStation 4.
Stealing cars.
And whatever else comes up, unless you have something specific you'd like to talk about.
You know me, I'll talk nothing but non-specifics throughout the entire future of this.
All right.
Let me talk around things I know and not know about.
All right, well, let's get started.
I'm American.
So what was that, like a 900-mile round trip kind of thing?
Oh, shit. All I know is this. We took a what year is that, 2000?
Yeah, it's like a 2003 Ford Windstar.
Ford Windstar. Two dudes weighing 500 pounds, cruising with like minimal gear, straight to Michigan from Virginia, $60, one tank of gas. How cool is that?
Pretty cool.
I could tell right away this was going to be rad. They were all kind of cool, like fuck ups on the road. Every 10, 15 miles, somebody tried to fucking kill us.
I was kind of grannying some of the driving, and it runs on synthetic oil, so it did really well on gas mileage.
But we had everybody that wanted to cut us off or pull out in front of us would and did. And we're getting on an entrance ramp to 77 in West Virginia, and a fucking tow truck pulling a truck pulls out in front of us. While we're going, 45, gaining speed, and this guy pulls out going nowhere with a fucking truck that has a license plate from where?
Michigan.
That was a good omen right there. We didn't die. We're on the way to Michigan. Fuck it. Let's do it.
Yeah. We got on a boat on Michigan, thanks to Jeff Presley.
I was on a boat, everybody, with real, like, what was that thing called?
It's a pontoon boat.
Yeah, this is, like, not a
speed
boat.
It was on Zucky Lake, part of the lake channels there.
I was on a boat with a motor, and that was really cool.
It was nice. I got a little, almost like a little bit of a burn.
I got burnt.
Yep. Had a really good party that evening.
Really,
saw some really great people.
Really burnt there.
But that was post Faith No More. Pre that, we met up with our buddy Daryl, who is in
Farting Corpse.
Yeah, the noise outfit, Farting Corpse, formerly of Calloused, formerly of 12 Gauge Nylons, formerly of Half Dog Jury.
Hell yeah.
If that means anything to anybody.
My best friend in Michigan.
Yeah. Yeah, and so we picked him up and rolled to Chicago to see Faith No More. And that was like a 3-hour, almost 4-hour drive from where we're at in Michigan to Chicago.
We had the tunes cranking and the wax dripping and smashed right on in to Chicago an hour and a half before the show to get in line.
Stopped at a Fred Meyer for the first time, and I hadn't been to Meyer in, oh my God, forever. Picked up some
Is that where I got paranoid? Okay, cool. So I'm in Michigan and I got paranoid. I walked in and I go, I don't know what to do. I was on the phone with my girlfriend. I end up going outside and leaning up against a post right in front of the door because I don't know where we parked and where the guys are. So I'm literally like, decision making. It was great. 10, 15 minutes later, they pop out. I forgot all about this. But now I'm remembering. Fuck you. I don't have a sense of smell, folks. I had a head injury about 10, 11 years ago. Damaged some of my brain. All the good parts, probably. No sense of smell. So Duane, knowing this and being the great friend that he is, he goes in on his little trip into this place to get whatever supplies he needs.
I needed a shower curtain.
Oh, shower curtain, right. What was that? Well, okay, so he gets Play-Doh, which is something that, this is a nostalgia factor thing. Play-Doh, Jesus Christ.
Play-Doh has a delicious odor that brings you right back.
All I can do is lick
it. It was pink, by the way. I bought pink Play-Doh.
He brought pink Play-Doh, and casually as fuck, he happens to sit down in the driver's seat. I'm shotgun. Daryl's in the back. He pulls open the bag. He puts this down. He puts that down. He's all good. He pulls out Play-Doh and just pops it right open and smells it. And he kind of looks over at me. I literally turned into the Incredible Hulk. I never get, like, blind rage, but fuck, man, that was heavy. I literally got up out of the van, slammed the door. All my muscles were tensed. Like, I was like, I'm walking home or I will crush. I blew off a bit of steam, went back in. As they're both smelling this, Daryl didn't quite get it right off. But once he realized that Duane was being a total fucking sadist, super rad. And then, you know, obviously, I want a piece of the pie. So I licked the pink Play-Doh to get a little nostalgia factor of my own.
How'd it taste?
It tasted like fucking Play-Doh.
Yeah, see, I never tasted
Dirty, Play-Doh. Dirty, salty, Play-Doh. Stinky. You know,
I think
it's
one
not
of the neighbors.
Free.
When I was growing up, one of the neighbors' kids' mom made their own Play-Doh. It didn't have much of flavor, but apparently it was edible, and these kids would eat some of their Play-Doh. But I never ate Play-Doh.
Play-Doh was edible.
I did get it like stuck into my parents' carpet and had it banned for a few years. From like the age of like 5 till 8, I was not allowed to have Play-Doh.
Wow.
But yeah, pulling into Chicago, that was my first trip to Chicago personally. And
yeah, me too.
The worst traffic I've ever personally been in my life. Terrible traffic. But we got there super early because we were being
have
like...
Have you been to California?
I've not been to California.
Cool.
I've not been further west than Vegas.
Chicago was like easy breezy compared to any time. Like, traffic...
You're talking about L.A. traffic specifically?
Southern California, in the lower parts. Yeah. L.A. traffic's horrible. Yeah. Hollywood traffic is fucking... It depends on the time of day because you can cruise and it's fine and then there's like all of a sudden 2 minutes, every single person in the entire place gets out of the woodwork and they're all smashed in one spot.
I'm sure that every place's traffic gets bad once in a while. I lived in New York City.
Well,
once
we were
in a while,
going
to
Chicago
bad,
at 4:35.
It wasn't
so
that bad,
was...
yeah, but in at like 4:35 in the afternoon in Chicago, and that was on a Friday? No, that was on
Thursday.
Or
Friday. I don't know. All the days blur together.
Yeah, it was Thursday, May the 7th, and the traffic was the worst I've ever been in. But it was like 8 lanes of traffic.
Have you been to New York?
Yeah, I lived in New York.
New York traffic's bad on the way in.
Not as bad as that.
Yeah, I don't know. I was stuck for a while when we were on tour. But yeah, it was cool. We got there, got in line. We got waters at the little wherever.
It was a CVS pharmacy right outside of the Concord Music Hall in Chicago,
and
Illinois.
Turbo Taco right across the street. It's Turbo kind of Taco. A sketchy roll your dice gamble, but you know, with 3 guys in line and 1 running for tacos, we pulled it off successfully.
Now, I personally did not partake in the tacos because I've been to concerts where half the concert I'm sitting there like, you know, with
shit down running down your leg.
Either having to use the bathroom or terrible heartburn. I'm having none of it. This is my Faith No More show. I'm not fucking up with goddamn street tacos.
So we really reserved a hell of a spot because, you know, when we got there, obviously, we're at the end of the line, which is only about 25 to the door. Well, by the time 6:55 rolls around, we've got patent freaks all over singing, quoting, fucking... banter, name drop this, name drop that, oh, this and that. I'm like, wow, you guys are rad. I've never seen Faith No More, and I don't know any of their songs, but for some reason, I have more of a fucking, like, I feel, like, more empowered than to just blindly talk and rant about things that I don't necessarily know about because I'm wearing the T-shirt.
Those bands where the fans are too cool to wear the band's T-shirts. Faith No More is not one of them.
No.
The only version of that there might be in a Faith No More shirt is someone would show up in a Mr. Bungle or Tomahawk shirt.
Right.
But they're still going to wear something.
Yeah, they're going to say, hey, Mike, call me out. I know you will. So we end up getting in there right on, and they just had some great... They had great merch right off. I wasn't completely, like, into spending all my money because I knew I would need it in other places. I'm kind of an eater. And on this trip, we ate out. And Mr. Jeff loves to eat out. So we ate out a bit.
Right.
So I decided to save some of my money for the next night, just in case.
The merch I picked up was a poster for Chicago signed by the band. It's got, like, a priest, like, pulling down a little kid's underwear. Kind of thing.
Yeah, it's the it's an old suntan lotion parody where it's like a little girl getting the side of her diaper tugged on by a little dog, I can't remember. I'm only 30.
It's like a horny Catholic priest trying to get into a little kid's pants. It's a horny Catholic
priest getting in a little altar boy's pants, yeah.
Right.
And it's super, it's drawn in the style of like medieval Spawn and Witchblade, kind of like the gnarled teeth and the wrinkled eyes, a little bit more like.
It kind of reminds me of like Rat Fink kind of art, a little bit.
Yeah.
Really dope artwork. That was like $75. But like I say, it was signed by everybody in Faith No More, and I hadn't seen him since like 2005. My God.
And the cool thing about that was that Duane decided that...
No, 2010 was the last time I'd seen him.
Between the three of us, we could have like a game plan. So we're like, all right, Duane's going to go up and he's going to like secure a good spot. And, you know, Daryl and I were going to go check out merch, get Duane the poster. I'm going to try to get a shirt or something or see what's going on. So I pass on everything, go upstairs. There's Duane, like, front row, pretty much center. And I get up there with Daryl, and then they're like, yeah, this is, like, our seventh or eighth Faith No More show, so we're going to go hang in the back where it sounds good and don't have to deal with the bullshit. But here you go, Sean. Here's, like, the fucking front row spot for you. I was stoked. And it was cool because they had, like, they had the barricade. And behind the barricade, they had, what, like a foot and a half, maybe 2 feet max of a step up that was about 2.5-3 inches. Just enough to make you uncomfortable if you're standing right on the edge. So you have to choose whether to be on or off. And if you're behind it, it kind of impedes you from pushing against people in the front. So,
I absolutely hate those steps.
Unless you're right in front of it and you're standing securely on the step. Because then the right. douchebag where behind I, you can't yeah. smash your rib cage against the fucking barricade. Because at shows where you don't have that, that's exactly what's happening. There's a small person in the front who wants to see a show, and fucking chaos in the form of 1,000 pounds of people pushing directly against one person.
Yep.
So that step kind of came in handy. But
I'm 38 years old, and I of course have I've seen Faith No More front row center, like in New York City. I've seen him front row center in Detroit. I've seen him front row center in Florida. So I don't need to be front row center anymore. What I do want is that first railing behind the crowd that's gonna fucking go nuts. And it's eye level with the band. Center there. I've got that railing. I can set my drink down.
Center,
set
man.
My poster
the
down.
Eye
and it's,
of the storm.
It's just gorgeous at that spot. That's where, at the age I'm at, that's where I want to be. But I did secure the spot for you to be right up front for your first time seeing them.
Yeah, and for me, it's like if I was like 5 or 6 years younger, I could have totally had a whole different approach to that show. And most shows, in fact. But this one, you know, like this one was really cool because it was like, you know, I'd been anticipated this for a really long time, and I actually never thought about it as far as, like, this is going to happen. I was just like, man, I want to see Mike Patton again, you know? I never got to see Phantom Oz when they came.
You saw what, Tomahawk?
I saw Peeping Tom.
Ah, you saw Peeping
Tom. I saw
Peeping
Tom in, like, 2007 in North Carolina, and it was awesome. It was really cool. Like, my favorite thing about that show is Mike's presence when he just, like, kind of called, he, like, stopped the music and called out the crowd. And was like, "What's up, guys? You know, you're at a fucking show. You're at a rock show right now. Like, what the fuck? Get
and
your
people
ass."
People just standing around.
Yes, everybody was standing around, kind of too cool for school, with their arms crossed, like kind of bobbing their head a little bit. And there was a shitload of people there. Like,
where's this, North Carolina? You said?
Yeah, it was at Carrboro, North Carolina, at the Cat's Cradle, which is a good venue. I've seen some punk shows there that've been really fun. And,
I'm not sure how crowds are in North Carolina. I've never seen a show there.
I think people. I mean, it was interesting because there was like. It was a rap opener, Pigeon John, which that year and the year before I had seen. I think that had been like the fourth time since I had run across Pigeon John and shows. Really cool guy and interesting, kind of goofy, corny, like not like, I don't know what it would be comparable to, like old Will Smith rap, the way that like just the story, like little ballads and stuff, not really cussing much, kind of making fun of himself. He would do the pigeon flap. But anyhow, Mike was doing his like R&B singing. Singing stuff with his like fedora and shit, and wife beater with his like. Right. It was cool.
That fucking Peeping Tom album is pretty great.
Yeah, it's class, sexy.
Yeah, I've never seen a show in North Carolina. So the crowds are there. It was my first show in Chicago, and the crowds there were pretty fucking cool.
It was cool. Yeah,
really,
there was
really cool people at that show.
It was exciting because you know, there's a lot of anticipation. You know, we got there right at 7. So what time's the first band play? 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
So we're standing there for an hour.
Yeah, no, we got there at 6:30. We stood in line for an hour and a half, just about.
Yeah, if we got there at 5:30, Doors opened at 7, and okay. we were in.
And now, most shows I wouldn't do that for, but yeah. those particular shows I do that for.
Well, I kept getting like a better and better feeling because I was still standing in front row, and I would look back and I'd be able to see you and Daryl, but between us was like completely packed. I was like, damn, these motherfuckers wish they could be me. And I'm like 6'4", and I'm standing on a fucking little block. So I'm like 6'7", 6'8", mm-hmm. in the front row. So fuck you. And it was like so much anticipation. You're sitting there like, oh, God. But the cool thing that I was bringing up was that around me were all these people who were, you know, just so stoked. Like, there's, you know, everybody's getting to see Faith No More. This is like... their chance. Here's our chance. They're in Chicago.
They hadn't played that town in more than 18 years.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like, holy shit.
In fact, that was the Concord Music Hall was very small. I don't know exactly what capacity was. Maybe you could have a feel for what capacity was, but it was very small.
Well, you got to think about the capacity being the music hall, not the actual place of music, because as I remember it, it was a 3-story bit. Remember right. the second story yeah, was caged
it's
out?
Also a bar.
So they had the capacity isn't for each, maybe the room capacity would be different from the total venue.
But I mean, how many tickets were sold capacity?
I don't know.
I'm thinking somewhere like probably 1,200 maybe.
Definitely something around. Yeah.
Maybe south of 1,000 even. It was a very small place. And the tickets for that show sold out unbelievably fast. We're talking like maybe 30 seconds, and people were very pissed off about how ticket sales were handled, and a lot of those tickets went on this bullshit site called StubHub, people are reselling them, and some of those tickets were going for like $300 for that show.
$350 for the
$350?
There was a guy next to me in Chicago that had two tickets, and his brother couldn't do it. There was something that was like, it broke both their hearts.
yeah.
But he had talked about seeing, he just saw him in California or something.
Yeah, there was a girl in front of us in Detroit. We were on that railing and she's on the floor. And she was from Chicago but could not get to the Chicago show because of those ticket prices.
What's funny
so drove her ass to Detroit instead of the town where she lived to see Faith No More because you could get a ticket for that show. I think that sold out in like, I'd say 2-3 hours, but they were segmented in how they sold like a few hundred tickets on like a band presale. And on that Friday they sold some more. But each day they would sell out within just a couple of hours. That's in Detroit. In Chicago, I'm telling you, those tickets sold out in a minute.
Oh, yeah. And everybody was so stoked, man. The guy that I was mentioning that sold his ticket for $350 was probably standing within 10 feet of the girl that you're talking about in Detroit.
Oh, he was there.
Yeah, it was that redheaded guy that was wearing an Adidas jacket or something and a cap. But, you know, the girl next to me and behind me was like, talking, you know, I was standing in this place, you know, for an hour, just listening to like the 10 people that are like smashed around me shoulder to shoulder talking about their personal loves for Faith No More or this and that. And just like a lot of, you know, it was just kind of cool, emotional, like contact. Like, I'm like, wow, this is cool. I'm kind of uncomfortable. I should have drank more water. Maybe I need some like vitamin C or like, you know, I should have eaten some vegetables. I ate these beast tacos and my brain is melting. This is cool. And with that anticipation, all of a sudden, the lights go down and fucking the Butcherettes, is that how you say their
name?
Yeah,
that's right.
I don't know.
The opening act for both the Chicago and Detroit shows was the Butcherettes. Not 100% sure where they're from. Most of their music is in Spanish. And they fucking rock.
Yeah, they were cool. They had like some really cool like post-punk energy with some like stage antics of like yeah, yeah, yeahs. You know, like,
yeah,
some
a little
hair
bit of
pulling,
like yeah, yeah, yeahs.
Some like crotch flashing, some fucking like rubbing, some weird like, you know what really struck me was the female vocalist, you know, frontman spot. She was doing these moves behind the keyboard that were like really reminiscent of like Ian Curtis from Joy Division.
Right.
Yeah, he had these like he had epileptic seizures and stuff, and he had these very like weird kind of I'm trying to do these dances, but she, you know, she was doing that weird like, you know, that's kind of jagged angular dancing, and their music was really cool, like post-punk.
Yeah, and she would transition between playing guitar and playing like a keyboard set that she had.
Yep.
And then just running through the crowd.
Yeah,
I think
she
ran through the crowd in Detroit. I don't think she did that in Detroit, but she would like get on all fours and crawl around
the
stage.
Or how about in Chicago?
Yeah, she did a stage dive.
Right into my face. Yes. Like, we're talking, it was really strange, too, because I'm standing in front row, like, kind of, like, being hypnotized by this weird thing that's happening. Because I've been in, you know, some good bands, and I've had an opportunity to work with really good drummers. And when you're working with a great drummer and you're playing bass, you get into this kind of, like, mechanical, like, mechanistic kind of groove where you're just holding down something that is super solid and super steady that you can't really break, no matter what kind of edgy, strange, avant-garde explosions you're putting around it. So I'm like, kind of in this weird kind of hypnotized thing that they're doing with the bass and the drums, because they were incredibly locked in the entire set and never had much more stage presence than just being awesome at rocking with what they were doing.
Oh, yeah, they were super tight.
This manic, fucking feral type of, like, other Ken... fucking, oh, like, this bitch, she's nuts, and it was really cool. But, you know, like, I'm doing all this, like wow, this band is, like, nuts. This rhythm section is just like a fucking machine, and this lady's just, like, spasming all over the stage. And right at that moment, I'm, like, looking up at her. She looks at me and fucking throws off her guitar and just comes flying straight into my head. And I was like, wow, what the fuck? That was so... whatever.
Yeah, and she did, like, almost like a 3-minute, like, crowd surf to get back to the stage while the drummer and the bassist just took care of shit.
It was, yeah, that was so cool, because that really made me appreciate where I was coming from with the last group I was in, Heva Hava.
Right.
Because that had that same kind of spirit where it was just kind of, like, really solid at what you're, you know, what music is going on, but the crowd can't do much more than just be enthralled by the original power, you know.
I wasn't familiar enough with the Butcherettes to tell you the names of the songs, what their album is, right off the top of my head, but I'm gonna drop some for you guys right here. That's Le Butcherettes. They're fucking great.
I bought the t-shirt. Actually, it was, yeah. And, you know, I watched them first night. She smashed my skull. That was cool.
Yeah, I think you kind of fell in love a little bit.
Nah, I don't do that. I'm in love. Hi, Abby. We had a cool night, though, that in Detroit, because she ended up from flying off the stage and kind of did this disappearing act where she didn't go stage diving. She went off to the stage, and then she pops up behind the crowd and pops up right in the center of our little bubble again.
That's right.
And ends up hanging kinda, and giving a hug to your friend Stephanie.
That's right. Yes, yes. She was dancing with the people in our group. It was
just
crazy.
Like, she was there again, like right next to us, all weird, and then she just disappeared. But that was a cool band. I've never, ever, ever seen anything like this in Chicago. This was fucking... This like... kind of haunts my subconscious that, like, this is part of somebody's deal. But, like, when she left the stage, she, like, aggressively rubbed herself on the crotch, like, inside of her fucking tights, which was gnar-gnar. I was like, what the that's crazy. And then she got down on all fours like some weird, like, autistic kid and, like, just kind of tumbled off into the side stage while the drummer and the bass player and a couple of the road crew took down the gear, and that was that. She never reemerged to the stage for anything. They were off, And then you've got these guys in white that come out looking kind of
like nurses'
aides. Yeah, they've got the V-necks and the scrubs, and they proceed to unveil like everything's veiled in white, and they start.
The backdrop is pure white.
Everything's white. They bring out the. They start bringing out flowers. I'm like, look, a thing of flowers. Oh, how lovely. Now, oh, it's two things. Okay, here we go. Put it on top of that. Yep. Oh, now we put one in front of the drums. Okay, now we got three. We got some symmetry.
And then it just keeps going into the whole thing. It looks like either a wedding or a funeral.
A wedding or a funeral or some kind of a weird intervention from the future, but in the past.
And then the flowers are all like pink and blue pastel. It's very... It's surreal.
And it started to get a little bit intense because for me, I just got rocked by the Butcherettes. I'm sweaty. I'm packed against people. There's been stage dives. There's been people trying to press. You know, like that was the thing for me. People were like, you know, putting their elbow into my rib to try to get me out of the way. Yeah. So I'm like, yeah, really? Fuck, bam. Hit him off the step. Fuck you. And in front of me, there was like a small lady. So I had my arm like, pressed against the fucking barricade between a couple people to put my body weight pressing back against them so I wasn't smashing into her. And that was cool because, you know, at Chicago, because at the end of the show, she respected the fact that I did that and turned around and was so happy that she didn't get smashed that she let me come out or come around her to the front, and I got to be like right against the barricade when I was really fucking tired. Now, this is for the encore of the second act, which was it Phil Collins? Wait, not Phil Collins. We saw, who was it? Oh, yeah, Faith No More, I remember.
Faith No More.
Jeez, my mind wanders when I start thinking about, okay. You know. Anyhow, I'm being facetious if you don't notice. So anyhow, we're waiting, blah, blah, blah. It starts getting uncomfortable because I'm starting to get tired in the fucking... Music is playing on, and they start playing Muzak, and they're playing like, you know what I mean, Muzak, like the stuff you hear in elevators, and like.
Yeah, at one point they even played Midnight Cowboy, which I didn't even like. You realize Faith No More covers this song? Why is this part of the Muzak?
And I kept thinking like, damn, Duane and Daryl are like sitting down, fucking bastards.
We actually weren't sitting down. We were just leaning against a rail.
They were leaning. These guys had to lean against the rail. And watch some bitch. It was very
comfortable.
Right?
Very comfortable. Yeah, there were. Well, we were kind of right behind a bar, and I don't know why people do this. Like that show was so hard to get into, but there were women. I guess maybe their boyfriends took them there or something. Like, who could give a shit? They're just getting fucking shit faced at the bar, never turning around to look at the band. Once it's just. And you know alcohol at those shows are just ridiculously expensive.
Right, yeah.
We're talking like
$9 for $6 to $9.
Oh, no, they're doing shots. They're doing fucking whiskey.
Right, exactly. That's why I wanted to tell people that it was $9 for a Budweiser, because if you look at a Bud and you look at a shot of whiskey, you're looking at like maybe $10 a shot.
Yeah. They're getting so they're getting so fucked up, they're beyond the point of remembering any of the details that happened at this show.
I do not understand
why people do that. Like, I would do that at a show that I didn't give a fuck. Like, you drag me to a show, I might behave that way if I don't give a fuck about the band.
Correct. And I guess
that's what they're up to. But that show was so hard to get into, it's a shame that the tickets went to those people.
That's actually really true. But the fact was, everybody that was close to me in that area was stoked to be there in the front. And throughout the entire, like, I mean... What happened, you know, we waited for a really, 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 really fucking long time. And on my way to Chicago, we're still talking to Chicago, this is awesome. So, on the way there, we're like in the van talking about what songs they're going to play. What are they going to open with? And I'm just like, dude, I want to hear From Out of Nowhere, man, or Caffeine, or like Land of Sunshine. I'm getting excited about what I want to hear, man, because I love Angel Dust, the album. Angel Dust. Because I've been saying that out loud. Like, I love talking. Like, it's hilarious. Like, let's clip out about it. I love talking about that because I end up always laughing. I'm like, oh, shit, in retrospect. I'm, like, sitting here having breakfast in a sterile environment yelling about how awesome Angel Dust is. And like, holy shit, like Angel Dust is like the best fucking one you can do, man. Like, you gotta do it with headphones on. It's fucking amazing, dude.
Yeah, it's pretty much one of the most crazy drugs. YouTube videos of people using this drug, Angel Dust.
No. We're talking albums. See what I mean? That's how it works, folks. And I'm like, Angel Dust? No. Is that PCP? You trying to get me wet, man? I only get wet in pools.
Yeah, the band opened with with a song off their new album. It was the single they put out for Free Record Store Day back in November. It was the song Motherfucker.
Which I can relate to. Quite.
Which is fucking a great opener. A song none of us have ever seen live before.
A lot. Like, you know, for a guy like me hearing somebody say motherfucker, I'm like, hey, that's me. You motherfucker.
But right after that song, they did play Land of Sunshine from the first song off of Angel Dust.
Which hit me. Because I was like, oh shit, this is happening. Oh, and they came in
and
hot,
it's so
dude.
Rocking.
It was, okay, so the setup was cool. When they come out, they're all wearing white. Except for the drummer who had like, excuse me. They're all wearing white.
Yeah, he's just got like a white
He had a wife beater on. And the other guys had like, each one had an individual white kind of like button up.
It's sort of almost like nurses uniform Mike, or like orderlies or
Mike
something.
Mike had like a weird like.
Or they're dressed for like a Tibetan funeral.
Yes, Mike had a weird like Tibetan.
Some kind of sash.
A sash with a little bead on it and something. It definitely looked.
I'm not sure what the story is behind that. If someone wants to let me know, go ahead and comment on the YouTube video or send me a thing on
it was
Twitter or something.
The
I'd
energy,
love to know what the deal is with
the energy
sash.
That they captured with Motherfucker, because it's kind of a building thing, you know? It's got like a drone-y kind of vocal thing, and it builds up. You got this power that comes in, and then it's like very, what's the word? What is it? It's epic. It comes in, and
it's almost like a non-song kind of, because it doesn't have it doesn't feel like a normal song. It's more like a statement. You know, I the thing I got about Motherfucker, like that song was basically a big fuck you to the record industry and to the like radio industry. Like, here's our newest single we're putting out and first time in 18 years. Oh, and by the way, it's called Motherfucker, so you're probably not going to play it either. Suck our dick.
Yeah, and it's, you know, that's exactly what you should do because it's awesome. And they build it up, and then right when you're just like... And the cool thing is that, you know, at that point in time, right, the record just got released this past week.
At the time of the shows we saw, the record had not been released.
The record had not been released, but everybody's singing the song, so that's cool.
Yeah, because, well, it was a single.
It's a single that's released, so you got... That's the best way to do it with bands, and that's where you get successful... with getting fans and stuff, is you play really good shows and you throw out, you know, obviously with Faith No More, they're established, so they're fucking Faith No More. But if you're like a working band and you're starting out or whatever, get your shit tight, make some good fucking songs, get them right, make a 3-track EP and give it away to the kids at your shows. They're going to listen to it. They're going to remember the songs. They're going to learn all of them because they're not overwhelmed with like all your album. You give them like a couple, 3 minute songs, like one or two, and then when you come back in like a month or something and you play that same place, they're gonna fucking be there at your show singing, and people that are there that haven't heard you are gonna be like, holy shit, like everybody's singing their song, what the fuck. Yeah. And the next thing you know, you've got fans everywhere singing your song, and all you have to do is the shit you're already fucking doing, which is rock and roll. And that's what Faith No More is doing right now, man. When they kept that shit rocking, what came after that? Caffeine.
That's right.
Because I was like, this is it. Yeah,
for a second there, my blood went cold. I'm like, holy shit, they just followed up Land
they're
of Sunshine with Caffeine.
Angel
I'm like,
for me, front row,
exactly.
Man,
I'm
Chicago.
Like, oh my god, are they gonna play fucking Angel Dust? Is this what this show's gonna be?
Right, totally.
Didn't work out that way, but the song after that was Evidence off of King for a Day, Fool for a Lifetime. That's the this kind of swinging number. And the video, they're kind of behind glass at a bar.
Oh, in the music video?
Yeah, the music video for that particular song. They went on to play Epic. They always play a song. Personally, I could do without that particular song, but it's a crowd favorite. Even though it's kind of funny how that song is a crowd favorite, but those people who've been out with that band all along, it's kind of like you know, literally VH1 had a list of top one hit wonders, and Faith No More made that list with Epic. And to us, and people who are huge Faith No More fans, that song, we love it. But it's a little bit of an eye roller for us because it's like, if you call up a radio station for the longest time and say, would you please play us some Faith No More? We'll get that right on for you. Hey, guys, just one thing. Oh, would you mind playing any song other than Epic? Can't help you.
Yeah.
Like that. So that song's got a little bit of an eye roller.
And really funny about this to me is, you know, I'm in a small town. I'm telling everybody in January, dude, I'm going to see Faith No More. I got tickets. My buddy Duane got tickets. Oh, shit. We're going to see Faith No More. What's that? I gotta start singing Epic, and they're like, oh, okay, cool. Yeah,
that one, yeah, okay. Do you notice they're playing Epic differently now? They're playing it a little bit more. As a musician, how would you describe the way they've changed that
they've
song?
They've put a little bit more, I think, in
there's more emphasis throughout it.
There's more, there's more syncopation in it. There's more, it's almost more, it's got more of a drag in here and there. Like, there's a drag to it in places where I was always, mm-hmm. when I was listening to it, I was like, wow, that's kind of, it feels like a slower kind of push to it. Where on the, it feels like maybe there's like more like ride cymbal or something in it. And this one was just more like chunky. And right. like, there was more,
it also didn't have that guitar ending.
There was, like, you know, there's some parts in that that have the, like, the big two guitars and, like, the solo. And it had that, but it just didn't have that same feel to it.
The Epic is totally different now, how they play it now, than how it used to be.
A garage feel to it this time, whereas then it had more, like, a neoclassical kind of a feel to it.
It doesn't have less guitars, or less keyboards, excuse me, but it feels like it does. And that ending at the end of Epic, that long keyboard ending.
I think he did it once.
I think that's missing.
I think he did.
Like, he maybe does it, like, doop, bloop, 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 and it's done. Whereas in the recording and how they used to do it, it kind of like went on. But after Epic, they played Sunny Side Up, which is, it's not my favorite off the new album.
I love the bass line, dude.
But it is one of the best songs off the new album. And it won't surprise me one bit if that's the next single that they put out.
Great. Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. And personally, I'm waiting for B-sides. I'm really hoping that there will be B-sides. So far, there's been two singles. That's Motherfucker and Superhero.
Right.
And each of them, the B-side has been a remix of the song. Both of them great remixes, by the way. If you get a chance to listen to them, please do. But I've been waiting for, like, the next B-side or Matador is my favorite song off the new record. But they played Get Out off of King for a Day Full for a Lifetime.
Holy shit,
which
heavy.
That, the fucking set list in Chicago was
a metal
lot
show.
Heavier. It was a lot heavier.
And if we're comparing now, contrast, the fucking show in Chicago was like a fucking crowd pleaser, fan kind of thing. There were less people. It was more intimate. The set was, the stage was set. You had fucking diehards, and then you had this one fucking guy with like a Yankees cap backwards and a fucking Behemoth shirt in the front, and Mike starts picking him, and he's like, oh
yeah, that was the thing. He kept going back to this guy.
He goes, that's a piece of Chicago beef right there. Yeah. And like, you know, he does his mic bit, he's looking him in the eye, oh Behemoth. Ooh,
yeah, like every
that?
Couple of songs he would keep fucking with that guy.
And he's like, what's that? A black metal band. You know, dude's like, yeah. You see him, he's like, yeah, you want to hear a blast beat? And you could see this guy, like, at a Faith No More show, maybe, like, looking down at Mike, not even looking at Mike's eyes or his face, just kind of looking down and to the right or whatever. And then he says, do you want us to play a blast beat? And he looks up at him in the eyes like a little kid, like, oh, a blast beat, yeah! And fucking, you see it for, like, you know, 1 second.
Yeah. Patton rolled out the fucking black metal vocals
if you listen to Mr. Bungle, you can definitely say, Mike, you're just totally messing with. See, because I was going to fucking, you know, like, I'm the kind of guy who has the discographies on my iPod and I listen to it with headphones while I'm doing things. So I don't always cross-reference titles, but, like, I definitely remember listening to, like, some, like, bootleg demo kind of Mr. Bungle shit, like really lo-fi.
They're really
shit.
Heavy, crazy shit. Never really wound up on the records, but they did a cover of. They used to do a cover of
Venom.
Billy Squier's "The Stroke," but they slowed it down immensely, and it would just be really fucking heavy and really drawn out. And it just
stroke me.
Yeah, but their shit was like. It was.
I've heard them.
It was
like,
demonic and fucking badass. Except for their very end, they just like pop in like. But what Patton did to that guy was reminiscent of that, and it was fucking awesome.
So yeah, getting back to Sunny Side Up, that song really kicks off. It's like if you think about what pop music is, and you think about what punk rock is, and you think about, or even say was, because the way I look at music and genre, it's always transitioning based on the ruling class eye. So to speak, like who decides what genres where and who labels who and who defines who. And then that kind of dictates people's approach toward like perceiving what genre is and what genre sounds like. What I think is going on with this record, Sol Invictus, and what Mike Patton and the guys are doing here with Faith No More on tour is that they're kind of taking what punk rock spirit truly is, which is being yourself to even your detriment and being extreme with who you are and projecting that onto other people and sharing that energy with other people through music. I feel like this is a great example of what true punk rock is all about, and what it is going against the grain completely and with aesthetic and with like quality, but at the same time with respect to it, you know, because I feel like that's a lot of, like there's a lot of people that, you know, look at punk rock in the past and they're like, oh yeah, you know, this is, you know, I know what that is. That's Sid Vicious and that's heroin and that's fucking getting drunk and it's oi oi and or it's, you know, like switchblades or leather pants. You know, it's whatever people decide it is. Well, fuck no. It's just being yourself and doing it, having fun with it.
Yeah. Faith No More's always had that spirit within all the deep cuts that they go through. Not just the singles, but those.
Fuck you. It's fuck really you. This is my life. Fuck you.
I'm probably going to go ahead and drop just a second or two or a little bit of Sunny Side Up right here.
Check out the bass line here, dude. And yeah, the fucking rhythms and the fucking harmonies and just the transitions here. And tell me that this isn't fucking pop music, but it's completely, you know, fuck you. We're better than pop. We don't need pop. Pop needs us. Fuck you. That is punk rock. And so check it out. And it's okay. Get me to the sugar bowl. Wow. Sun is out of
Anyway, that's Sunny. That's a little bit of Sunny Side Up, and it's strikingly optimistic. Striking, like the lyrics for the song are strikingly optimistic, and I don't even think they're ironic. I think whatever's going on with this song is genuinely optimistic.
You can hear
for a moment.
There's a retrospective emotion that is captured that I feel like is almost like Faith No More is standing on this mountain right now.
Uh-huh.
Looking down into the valleys of their past and looking at their new era that they've created for themselves, because, you know, they've been they're not really completely relevant to what's going on. You know, it's kind of an irreverent band that's created all these cool things and all these people love them, but they're not like, you know, like you were saying, they're a one hit wonder to the masses. So you look at what they've done, and you know they can go, you know, this is this record. This is what we sound like. Okay, let's look at the next one. Let's not go there. Let's take things that we've done and push it. And there's a maturity in their music that I feel is like a great hope to all musicians that are doing what they love, is that they can create a future from looking back and then building on that.
Yeah, that's a funny thing. The masses might not have heard them, but you'd be hard pressed to find a modern musician who doesn't know what the fuck they are.
Right.
Musician, they're like a musician's band. A lot of musicians consider them to be a huge influence. They're highly influential to a lot of modern musicians these days. Musicians coming up that are now in their early 30s or even late 30s are hugely influenced by this band throughout the late 80s and throughout the 90s.
It's the versatility, guys, out there. It's just like, go back and listen to all the records and just listen to the versatility and the transitions from album to album, from just songwriter to songwriter, who's in charge, what's going where. And go back and fucking find a VHS copy of, like, Video Croissant, fucking thrift store, you know, wherever, find it on eBay, and fucking watch it. And go back and, like, kind of take a look at what was going on visually with them, and fucking watch Mike Patton fucking play Caffeine on MTV, when I was like, holy shit, this is, like, the coolest thing
hanging with MTV.
That was on MTV. Like, holy shit, how is that not the coolest thing that you've ever seen? And, like, that was what I was looking at, like, that's hardcore. Mike Patton's, that's fucking hardcore music. But it's not, because you look at everything that was going on. Each person in that band created an atmosphere.
Yeah, being for a beast. I remember that moment. They were, like, being introduced by Downtown Julie Brown. They were Faith No More in the crowds. Crowds like those kids, like 90s kids wearing.
They've got, like, fucking flannel shirts tied around their waist, exactly. And fucking long fucking actually look like my shorts, like cargo shorts with long socks and fucking, they pretty much,
hyper color t-shirts and shit. And of course Faith No More breaks down this just demonic metal number just for a moment, and then breaks into to Caffeine. Holy
super
shit
cool. But anyhow, that kind of shit is still going on. Mike Patton's stage presence, all the guys. I want to give a shout out to the guy who gives Mike Ward his water, man. That motherfucker works his ass off.
He does, doesn't he?
You know, Mike's up there fucking, he's the oldest dude in the band. He's like 50, maybe. Probably. He's pushing 50. He's playing the drums out the fucking shit up. His style of drumming is awesome. Check him out.
I wouldn't be surprised if he was close to 60.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go. Maybe he's older than that.
I mean, Faith No More has been around since like 1982, and he was there.
What was cool is the guy's kind of hidden behind the amps of the guitar player, and he slides out every couple minutes. He might have like a stopwatch where he's like every couple minutes, and he'll just kind of like gently walk up behind the dude, pull his forehead back, and pour water into his head, and then just disappear. And it's like both shows. This guy's like fucking working hard. Anyhow, you fucking rock, dude.
Whoever you are, the water guy behind Mike Borden.
He's like the guy in the Bill Hicks comedy that's like, when he's doing the Elvis, he's like, hey, man, I need a towel, man. And I need a water. And there's that guy who's like, hey, man, what if I brought you a towel and I brought you water? And you only need one guy. He's like, man, you're a genius. And he's like, I was the guy that brought Elvis's water and his towel.
Hopefully he's well paid. He gets to hang out with the best band working today.
And the road crew for those guys were diligent. They were led by a dude who came out fucking pointing fingers and walkie-talking his ass off and making sure that shit was set up proper. And they did it right. And they rocked the shit out in Chicago. And then, so what else? Chicago.
After that, it was a midlife crisis.
Holy shit.
Yeah, which is excellent song. During the breakdown, the breakdowns were
elevator
different
music
in Chicago and Detroit. And I know normally they've been doing a breakdown that has some Boz Scaggs in it.
Oh, I know what they did. They stopped it at the second
which
chorus.
Is what they did in Detroit. But in Chicago, they did something different.
Right. In Chicago, they stopped it on the second chorus, and the crowd sang through the entire section, and then they stopped. And then what did they do?
They came out with some sort of jazzy number that I'm not personally familiar with.
Well, no, they didn't. They never. It was. They just played a little jazzy bit, and then he just started singing.
Right, but whatever that breakdown is, usually is something specific. I'm not sure what it is. If somebody listening knows what that little breakdown was in Chicago, it's not the one they did in Detroit.
No,
the one in Detroit was Boz Scaggs.
It just sounded like they played the same chords, like swingy, like lounge style. I thought about it like a lounge core, and like they kind of brought it in, and they're like doing their thing, and he starts snapping, and he's looking at you like a crooner. And
is that
like,
what they did?
That's what I thought they were
doing.
It
wasn't something specific?
They were just like, dink, 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 dink. Ring, ring, or whatever. I don't know. Maybe not. Hey, email us, Mike. Let us know what's up.
Now, if anybody knows what they did specifically in Chicago with regards to the breakdown of midlife crisis, let us know. After that was Last Cup of Sorrow, I think was only one of two songs that they played off of
Album of the Year. Wow, dude, I'm hanging on pretty good with all these. You know,
they didn't play a lot of stuff off of Album of the Year at these shows. They did not repeat playing Last Cup of Sorrow in Detroit, but in Chicago they did play that. After that was The Gentle Art of Making Enemies, which was totally badass.
Heavy fucking shit, right?
God damn it. And they brought it the fuck out.
Yeah, when they broke out anything metally, it was fucking power. It was powerful. The sound was killer. The Concord got brand new front PA speakers all the way across the front.
Like, oh, really?
They were brand fucking new.
How do you know this?
Because the guy in front of me that was like the security guy is like, uh-huh, be careful, these are all brand new.
Ah.
So the
monitor, not the amps we're listening to, but the monitor.
The
amps.
The house sound that's going into your knees, not the ones that are up on top,
right,
but all the ones across the front
Are they pointed at the crowd or the band?
The crowd.
Oh, okay.
The ones that were on stage are the monitors facing the crowd. This was the stuff that was between the stage and the crowd on the bottom, on the floor. It was awesome. The sound there was killer. Everything about that show was a perfect fucking success. From the crowd's point of view, I don't want to get into any speculations about how the bands felt about it or any fucking jerk-off out there who got too drunk because their boyfriend brought them to a fucking show and they broke their high heel off in some asshole. I don't know. Fuck them. The show was awesome. It was the coolest Faith No More show, you know, I've ever seen. It was the first one I saw. I got to see it right in front.
And it was front row for the encore. Extremely intimate. Definitely the smallest place I've personally seen Faith No More. And I've seen them 7 or 8 times now.
So that would be Chicago. We wrapped it up with fucking a ride back. 2 for $5 Big Macs. Yeah, can I get 6 Big Macs and couple 20 pieces.
Yep.
Fucking smash those.
But before that, I wanted to mention that they did play Cuckoo for Caca
in
Chicago.
Yeah.
And
that
show was
so
fucking
heavy. How do you remember
heavy.
This shit?
I don't just remember it. I actually fucking took notes, motherfucker.
I know. They don't.
Oh. Yeah, I took notes. I took notes
Duane.
on my phone during the show.
I considered
that they play.
But here's what's cool about this, and this is something I told Duane before this. One, I knew he would do it. Two, I don't know all the names of the songs. I know the songs. that's my Faith No More thing. Is I'm the guy
yeah,
like
you're an MP3 listener.
I'm a
so
rocker,
you don't,
man. Well, I don't have time. Like, and what's cool is that I have them all on my computer. And now that I've been in, like, have a home computer set up, I've been away from like a computer with iTunes. So I've just got like, you know, how often do you look at your iPod when you put it on shuffle and throw it up? So I'll just put on Faith No More's discography, and I've got all the shit.
And you're listening to it randomly.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I just put it on shuffle and just listen to it like that. Because that's the best way to get involved with a band, is to do past, present, and future and decide how you hear their history. Because there's a lot of bands, there's a lot of cool evolution. There's a lot of, like, genre bands that get misunderstood and things because they create a new record. Hi, we're a metal band, but here's our new record. And they hear it, and they're like, whoa, you don't sound like you sounded on the last record. Yeah, because we're musicians and we're a band and we evolve and we're doing our thing. Fuck you.
Faith No More,
and Faith No More is that band. And that's, you know, that's what's punk rock about it. They've never been like, oh, let's decide to, man, they're really going to like this. I hope they just shine on and buy this album. And it's like, no. You either belong here or you don't. Fuck you. And
I actually rarely listen to Faith No More that way. Just like random stuff. I never listen to Best Ofs. But I always listen to, like, an album. I'll listen to Just King for a Day Flow for a Lifetime. I'll listen to Just Angel Dust. I'll listen to Just Album of the Year. And the reason why I do this is because as these albums were coming out, I would just devour them.
Yeah.
The album, like, Angel Dust would hit, I just devoured that fucking album. From beginning to end, like, when that album that year, the 92, 93 years, I must have listened to that album 700 times.
That's cool. I didn't hear it until 10 years later.
And then when King for a Day came out, I just devoured that fucking album. Awesome. And I remember I would, like, you know, transfer my CD to tape, put the tape in my tape player in my car, and it would just stay in the car on loop basically the whole summer.
We're 8 years apart, folks. So there's a bit of a he's coming from a different school of rock. I wasn't, you know, I was like 10, 11 years old.
Yeah, I'm in my late 30s now.
So for me, looking back at these, like, Angel Dust was the go-to record
of that
work.
Summer. Yeah.
No, for me, like, just whenever I was working with, like, a bunch of different kind of people in a food distributor, and we were, you know, working. I was making, like, kale chips and cashew-based ice cream and nut butters at Blue Mountain Organics, and then ended up, you know, having the, like, a fucking pretty nice sound system for my iPod. Uh-huh. I'd bring that in, put on Angel Dust, and fucking every, you know, that was something that, like, I could turn people on to music that was different. They didn't mind it at all, because there's, like, you know, you got Easy, Lionel Richie cover, which they did, of course.
Yeah, that's a, that would, before I move on to that, I was just going to say the reason I listen to those albums in full is it brings me back to a very specific time listening to the albums. And I know, like, how one song leads into the next. And in fact, when I do listen to them on random or something like that, like somebody hits a best of,
it fucks with your head.
And when it hits the end of one song and it doesn't go to this other specific song, yeah, I'm like, that's not the right next song.
You know? I do the same thing with things like Injustice for All or...
by Metallica, right?
Yeah. There's other records, like... I can't even... I don't know. There's a lot of records like that where I listen to, like, consistently at one point in time. And when I hear them on shuffle like that, it does mess with my head, because the next song's supposed to kick in and it doesn't. Especially with the iPod on full shuffle, where it's not, like, within... I don't go to Faith No More shuffle songs and albums or whatever.
Uh-huh.
I'll go to, like, all songs shuffle. So you'll have, like, some kind of weird, like, Vader kind of, like... ritualistic intro that's all like, and then you hear ding 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 ding, and Tegan and Sarah comes on, and you're like, because, you know, it's like, what the fuck, how does it transition from that? And then after that, it's Two Live Crew, and then, you know, Faith No More, and then off into, like,
it's an interesting and very schizophrenic way to listen to music. Personally, I don't do that. I actually do listen to people's albums.
No, I listen to the albums, but I listen to music generally now at, you know, once I listen to the album a couple times, I've got the album. I know the album now. I'm that kind of person. And then I put my, I just, you know, continually listen to the music to kind of, like, hear it in a different way. That way I'm not focused on how they want me to hear it. I want to do it how I want to do it, which is organically, and let the machine decide what I hear. I give it the poison, and then it poisons me how it wants to.
What? But you were mentioning that they're played easy, and for some reason they're still playing it. It's a huge crowd favorite, which is the reason why.
Well, it's a cool song, but, because you don't necessarily, you know, you kind of, like, hear that song and you're like, oh, that's a good song. And then when you hear somebody embrace it like Faith No More and create a bit of, you know, a different feel to it. I mean, it's pretty much note for note, but they have, like, a different energy to it that creates, like, a
right,
better
and
feeling.
And the crowd sings along to it. I guess if I have a complaint about what Faith No More is doing right now, it'd be concerning the songs Easy, This Guy's in Love with You, and I Started a Joke.
Yeah, I started.
Now, the thing about these songs, these are huge crowd favorites. They were, like, as the years gone by, each Faith No More album, they would do a cover song or two cover songs.
War Pigs.
And there was, like,
War Pigs.
During the real thing, they did War Pigs. During Angel Dust years, they started doing Easy. For King for a Day, they started doing I Started a Joke, and during Album of the Year, they started doing This Guy's in Love with You.
Which is...
And that's a Burt Bacharach song.
Okay.
And those were, like, the cover songs of the era, and as those albums came out, you were always wondering, what is going to be the next Faith No More cover song that they do? Way are they going to do it?
Correct. Yeah, that's
right.
Cool.
And so far, and just like you said, maybe they haven't done it yet. That's been, like, the one, and that's not really a complaint because I love those songs too. But this time I have wondered, what song is Faith No More going to cover with this new batch of songs and in the key of Faith No More? And so far, that hasn't happened yet. Yet they're still bringing out those old, older cover songs.
You're looking for a puzzle piece right there.
I am looking for the puzzle piece.
Fucking solve the puzzle.
That's part of the new albums.
Totally.
Like, I Started a Joke and This Guy's in Love with You and even Easy were actually not on the albums that they go along with,
it's
oddly enough. But
did.
It's part of the, you got the album, and then you found out later it came out as a B-side,
well,
or they didn't even put it out as a B-side.
And they did one thing, though, I know, and we haven't gotten too much into detail about how Detroit went, but they did do a cover in Detroit for a minute, paying homage to Hall & Oates.
Yeah.
Mike was like, oh, yeah, Hall & Oates is playing up the road. What the fuck are you guys doing here?
Yeah, Hall & Oates, when we were in Detroit on May the 8th, Hall & Oates was literally playing right next door at the Fox Theater. We were at the State, it's not the State anymore. Now it's called the Fillmore, which is right Correct. Across the street from Comerica Park, across Woodward Ave. Complaint is I'm waiting, and like you said, maybe they haven't done it yet. I'm waiting for what is the B-side? What is the song that Faith No More covers this portion?
That's what it is. Like that guy Hall & Oates.
Yeah, that's not what they're gonna. That's like the joke of the evening.
Well, no. Never mind. My brain went directly to It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia to Charlie going like, yeah, Hall & Oates. He's one guy. And he's like, no, it's two guys, Hall & Oates. He's like, no, his name is Holland Oates. So I always think about this one guy who's like, anyhow. But they played Rich Girl for like a minute or two. So within reason, they did have a new cover for us at that moment. So right. Respect that at least as a part of your puzzle piece smacking in there if you look at it like that. They played Rich Girl and you saw it live.
During the Reunited during the Reunited shows in 2010 and 11, they were playing Peaches and Herb Reunited, which is as just part of that maybe. So maybe that is still the cover tune of the this era of Faith No More. Anyway, that's just an observation, but
Matador, dude. They played Matador. The imagery in that song, lyrically, is fucking like really cool and like provocative. Like get your brain thinking, stirring around, for to be smarter and better in the thinkings of smartness and such.
Matador is definitely my favorite song off the new album. It's sort of the king for a day of.
It's kind of like an operatic, ballady kind of like. Epic kind of a song because it doesn't really.
And it was the first of the songs that I heard it because
it's not a headbang. It's not a head bobbing kind of song. It's more of like drink a glass of wine and think about it while it's happening kind of song. Where it's like, wow, this is like heavy.
Yeah, that's definitely a wine song.
You know,
and it was the first of the song of this new batch of songs that I've heard because they played it live. I want to say back in like 2012.
Oh, shit.
They played it in, I think, in Chile, I think, is where they played it. And they only played it once before all this stuff hit. But,
they put it on this record.
Right. But nice. It was like the one time when, like, Faith No More just played a new song. And it was during the Reunited tours. They did play Matador. But, the very next day, we loaded up the car with potato skins and pickled wieners. And we headed to Detroit to meet some more of my friends who were in a band called Red Robe were waiting in line for us. That's Mike Rowland waiting there.
The guy with the no means no shirt.
Yeah, he used to be in a band called Fistful of Blood, and he also used to be in a band called Bo Herald. I think both of those things are kind of by the wayside, but currently he's doing Red Robe. They're fucking awesome.
That dude was cool, man. And he goes, thanks for knowing who no means no is. And the next day, motherfucker, I wore that no means no shirt that I brought on my trip. I was like, fuck yeah.
How did he know you knew who no means no? Did you have like a hat or something?
He had a Wrong t-shirt. Wrong's the record they released in like 94, I think.
Uh-huh. And you, oh, okay. Yeah, that dude's super cool. Probably even a bigger fan of Faith No More than I am. He was already waiting in line, like first in line.
And so we just cut in. We're like, damn, yeah. You're right at the front, bro. Look at all these dicks. Whatever.
Yep, he was there with a comedian from Michigan named Pat Hoban.
That guy was funny.
Yep, great guys.
That's a joke.
Definitely, thanks for letting us cut in line. You guys are scholars and gentlemen. Really appreciate
it. Fuck yeah, dude.
But that helped us get in, get our poster, get our slot, which this time you hung back with me in Detroit at the railing.
I did.
I'm glad you did because being up front, it's awesome. But sonically, I think you miss a little bit.
I hated the
whole band.
In Detroit.
Yeah, the Detroit sound was a little loud.
Their board, like the master output for that was really, really hot. Like it was so fucking hot. Like the highs on that thing were scorching fucking hot. And they pressed mics up like a couple times where he was like throwing out like a white noise kind of scream, and they shot it out in the stratosphere, and you know, I'm sure yours were ringing
it
too.
Was a piercing
mine
piercingly
were ringing
loud
for
show.
Like 2 days.
Yes.
and it was just kind of like...
That was the second loudest show I've ever seen. That's not necessary. They know.
No. That is... When you go to see a fucking band like Faith No More, you make them sound fucking great. Like they did the night before when you saw them front row in fucking Chicago. And I know you know that the sound was really fucking good.
I think they did sound great. They were really hot. I think maybe your ears aren't as destroyed as mine are.
Or maybe mine are way destroyed and I didn't have my earplugs. I don't know. Either way.
It was much louder in Detroit than it was in Chicago.
I thought it was much louder.
But it
louder
was the better show. God damn it.
Yeah. I'm not saying if the experience is okay. It's my first time, and I get the best time ever. Okay, this is your eighth time, and you have the best time ever too at a different show because all your friends are there, and you're fucking and the band is.
I think the band was more hit, and they played it was just a fucking amazing set. Like,
yeah,
there was more energy going on in Detroit than Chicago. Way more, and the crowd was way more into it.
Maybe I didn't have as much energy because I wasn't feeling so great.
Maybe it was you personally, but the band had more energy in Detroit, for sure.
When I went on this trip the first fucking day, when we were out, my throat started hurting.
Oh, yeah.
And I fucking started feeling kind of ill, and I'd been drinking, like, cough medicine and, flu medicine to try to get that off, and, I guess by that time, in Detroit, I had a couple beers that day. I had anticipated going on the boat. Dude, we were going to be on a boat, and then we went to go on the boat, and the battery was dead, dude. So me and Jeff just hung out sitting on the boat and drank like a fucking sixer of beer or something.
This is before Faith No More?
That's before you showed up in Detroit. Yeah. I was just hanging out, getting drunk. And by the time I made it to the show, I was probably, that's probably what it was, man.
So it wasn't you who... I mean, it wasn't the band who had less energy, it was you.
I had less energy, so I had less fun. But I think that both shows were amazing, and they're completely different. And you can actually check out Faith No More's Detroit show at Yahoo. They've streamed it live.
Yeah, and somebody has also put it up on YouTube.
Yeah.
I can't give you the link because almost definitely it'll be ripped down for copyright, and then somebody also put it back up.
But you can find it.
Yeah.
Check it out.
The sound of it sounds so different.
Oh, it's awesome. The sound was going straight from a dry mix out, so it had, like, instead of having, like, all the superpower, you can actually hear, like, what it would sound like.
It's night and day. Like, at that show, it was the sound was so loud and so full and so had so much attack. It would just floor you.
So here,
and then the next day we get this Yahoo stream of the exact same show, and it sounds so different.
It's like,
I'm just tripping out on it. Like,
God. It's like Faith No More Shreds.
It's so sterile.
Do you remember these YouTube videos? Like,
yeah,
Creed Shreds and Nickelback
right.
Shreds. The best one, one of the best ones, is Kiss Shreds, the original, and Steve Vai Shreds. Steve Vai makes the most funny faces. He's one of those virtuoso dudes who plays guitar. And, boy, they just, like, make somebody sound like shit and have those videos synced up with really shitty music. This was not like that because the music was great, but just the sound, it was strange to have been there in person and then to watch it. And you're like, oh, that's not what we saw. That's
definitely,
not how it
definitely.
Hurt my fucking
was
brain.
Night and day. So anybody who wasn't at that show who's watching it from that YouTube,
so
I just want to impress upon you, it didn't sound, it doesn't sound bad. It's just such a dry mix of it. And the show was just sounded wet and visceral. And
it was amazing.
So fucking
and
good.
And I've been downplaying this show only because I want to, like, get this piece out because this was, like, super, just super, super exciting and inspiring. They brought out Chuck Mosley.
Yes.
And that, for me, was like, see, I've been going on like, oh, Chicago was the better show. You know, no, it wasn't about better. It was about the experience of it. And that was where it, like, came full circle. When they got Chuck Mosley out, I was like, oh, my God, I just saw Faith No More front row in Chicago, and it's the best show. And now I'm fucking here in Detroit with all our buddies in Michigan fucking partying. I'm fucking half drunk, front row fucking middle in the eye of the storm, not having to worry about dicks bumping into me.
The dicks were in full force.
Except for our crew spilling drinks because they were partying too.
Yeah.
And fucking, we had a great show. We had a great fucking time. And when Chuck came out, it was like a bittersweet moment for me because I was like, fuck yeah, dude.
That was that was an incredibly rare thing.
They played Mark Bauer.
They've done that once before in San Francisco.
Okay.
I think like in 2000. I want to say 2012 they did that, when they did a couple of reunited shows in San Francisco.
They played Mark Bauer from Introduce Yourself.
Mark Bowen. And that song's from We Care a Lot.
We Care a Lot.
The album We Care a Lot.
And what was cool was that when he came out and started singing it, he was on Mike's mic, which was super hot.
Yeah.
And I mean, it was as hot as like when he put it to his mouth to say something, he got scared.
Yeah, you could tell he was super nervous.
He pulled the mic down.
Probably not in his best form. They probably didn't even rehearse it, I'll bet.
He pulled the microphone down past his, down past his abdomen.
He was kind of holding it like here. He was probably holding it, I want to say,
a foot and a half away
from his mouth.
Which was in, glaring contrast to Mike, who had it right in his mouth. Now,
those two are totally different singers, man.
But though that's what I'm saying. For me, like as a musician and as somebody who cares about sound, who cares a lot? I fucking care a lot.
Right.
I want everybody there to have the best experience. And when you're watching a show that's too loud, it's detrimental to the band because you can't really appreciate sonically what they're doing because there's too much wash in the mix.
Right.
And that's my big complaint. It's not that the band wasn't amazing. It's that the sound guy at Detroit, fuck you.
It was too hot. It sounded really, everything sounded really good. I could hear everything separated from themselves, but it was too loud. I'll give you that. But it sounded good, just too loud.
I thought that the wash created, just like, it was like, it would almost be like every single thing was clipping out, but like clipped out 25% more than it should be. And I can understand clipping a band out when it's loud, pushing the thing, but you got to have your levels proper before you do that.
I don't think they were clipping exactly. I think what it is that PA system at the Fillmore is incredible, and it can be pushed super, 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 super fucking loud.
That's what I get for only seeing shows in shitty dive bars.
That show did not clip, but our ears clipped it because it was too loud for us.
My shit was fucked.
It was too loud. That show was too loud.
And Chuck was loud, and fucking, it was awesome, dude. And then we got we got tacos again. Fucking tacos.
Yeah. But it was incredible that they brought out Chuck mostly. Obviously, it didn't look like he'd even had time to rehearse it. Mike Patton himself sat down on the drum riser just to watch. And it was a really fucking special thing for them to pay respect to their own history with us in tow. Like, we got to be there for that moment. And I think that happened one other time in San Francisco that they brought out Chuck. But how fucking cool that we have seen Faith No More with Chuck Mosley.
Yeah.
That's fucking badass.
Yeah. See,
and obviously you wouldn't replace Mike Patton with that guy, but it's fucking dope that we've seen a song.
How many
with
times
that guy.
Have you seen Faith No More?
Eight. Okay. Seven or eight.
I've seen him twice.
I gotta count.
The first one, front row center in Chicago. Second one, Detroit. And Chuck Mosley was there. See what I'm saying about my trip? It's a whole different fucking thing. And you gotta appreciate that. That's a puzzle piece for me that's like not just a piece of a puzzle. That's a fucking puzzle coming and going. It's actually like this. It's actually like me getting a fucking thick gauged cardboard poster and they're smashing it down on the table and then having somebody come over and cut it for me and be like, boom, you got your own puzzle, motherfucker. It's complete. Now you can put it in a box and put it back together whenever you want. And that's amazing. That's 100%, motherfucker. And
it,
that's something.
It was beautiful.
That's why I don't look at it as what was the better show. What do you mean, what was the better show?
They were different. Yeah, you had two different experiences. the Chicago show was more intimate.
Yeah.
You got to be right up front. It's a much smaller venue. It's a much heavier venue as far as the song selections because they played Cuckoo for Caca
and Get
Out. But let me
tell you this. It felt to me, just subjectively, like the heaviest fucking song they played was Surprise, You're Dead.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
When they started playing that, I was like,
in Detroit,
I need a battle axe. I'm hacking.
That was extremely exciting. But not only that, but they also played like Everything's Ruined in Detroit.
That was all right.
It was fucking, I thought it was way cool. Way cool. You look like you're about to say something and I'm trying to give you that space to do it.
No, I was just thinking like, just Surprise, Your Dead. It's like, I came back and I listened to it and I was like, damn, dude, they fucking like annihilated that song when they played it. It was like fucking full blown badass. And then you go back and listen to it on the album, you're like, oh, that's a good song, but it's just like,
yeah, Faith No More didn't really pick up that level of heaviness until Angel Dust. And so From Out of Nowhere is from the real thing. And in that era, they weren't doing things that heavy.
Oh, dude, that was so, the fucking moment, dude. They played From Out of Nowhere in contrast to the fucking Chicago. And when that happened, that was just like, you know, on the way there.
No, they played both of the openers from those two albums.
They did what I wanted. They did everything that I wanted them to do.
They're definitely crowd pleasers. Oof. Those motherfuckers are some serious crowd pleasers.
And they the behemoth guy, I actually like in Chicago, the front row guy with the black metal shirt.
Mike Patton was making fun of throughout the band.
I called him. I was like, oh god, I called him out. I was like, that's going to be the Duane. He's going to be the guy who he started a joke about this guy. I know he's going to do it. I said, this guy's got pink glasses on because I guess Duane saw him and.
In New York City, I was wearing pink glasses, and I was like basically right up front, basically front row. And
Duane's kind of tall, so you can't miss him.
At one point, when Patton finally addresses the crowd, he's talking about the heat of the show, and everybody reacts to that. He says, "No, that tall guy, that tall fucker, pink glasses, and that's me." So he asked me how I felt about that weather, and I just told him, like, I drove all the way here from fucking Michigan, so this isn't even my weather. And he made fun of my glasses, said my glasses were fucking bullshit, just like this weather. But then he said he's kidding, and he dedicated I Started a Joke to Me, kind of one of the better moments of my life. And
I noticed that guy got
that moment.
And it was funny. It cracked me up.
I like it. I love it when Mike Patton makes fun of fucking people in the crowd. I fucking love it.
Yeah, they were great shows. It was a great experience, man.
They were riffing on Hall & Oates all the way through that Detroit show. All the way through it. Wouldn't you rather be at Hall & Oates?
Well, that's kind of, you know, that I brought that up when, you know, with the Peeping Tom thing, is that he does have this cool kind of banter, and he usually, like, questions the thought process of his fans. He's like, in my mind, are we cooler than Hall & Oates? Have we reached that? Is that what you're saying? Maybe not. Probably not. Why are you here? And that's cool. It's always good to fuck with the crowd. It's always good to captivate, you know, and question.
Yep. So Detroit got Chuck Mosley came out and sang for him. And also we got a second encore in Detroit, which we did not get in Chicago. So we got an extra song. And they ended the show with the last song off the new album, Sol Invictus, From the Dead. And Roddy comes in playing acoustic guitar back up. And it's just a fucking amazing song.
That's cool. That's a great
way to end the album.
And now the album's out, so check out Sol Invictus.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's super fucking cool. Creepy little fucking dude on the album cover. And I didn't want to get the t-shirt because I got a 5-year-old kid. I wear gnarly shit, but I'm like, dude, that's genuinely scary.
Yeah, that's a new photograph. That kid is alive and well and basically that same age. It looks like a vintage. You know what I'm thinking of? The kid off of the superhero album, the 7-inch.
I think so. Is that what it is? It's like
it looks vintage, but I think it's a modern photograph. Yeah. And I don't know who the photographer is. Again, if you know some of these things that we don't, feel free to communicate with us. We'd love to hear from you. Tell us the shit we don't know. I want to know. I like some of this shit.
My thought process.
So who's the photographer and who's that kid?
And who's the guy here that's saying, yeah, I don't know, I got a 5-year-old kid and all my shirts like Pumpkinhead, Reanimator, Phantasm, go fuck yourself, eat shit, fuck off, burning corpses.
Anyway... So I would say we had a very successful trip to Michigan and Chicago. Nothing really went wrong, you know. Our vehicle held up. Tempers were cool. Like after the Detroit show, I was so worn out. We had Daryl driving us home, and I, you know, drove up from Virginia one day.
Drove to Chicago
and back. Yeah, we'll talk about that in a second. But I was just so fucking wiped out, and I let Daryl drive to Detroit and back from where we were in Michigan. Because I was so fucking wiped out from all the driving I'd done.
Oh, yeah.
But Daryl's a fucking maniac.
He's a good guy. He's a good driver.
Yeah. After the Detroit show, I was so worn out. Like, I was, like, a cunt hair away from being a real bitch to everybody. Because I was just, you know, that point when you're so tired, you're like, fuck off, everybody. Fuck off.
Right.
Yeah, I was at that point, and I'm like... Just like a minute away from bitching out here. let me get to my fucking couch and lay down and hit the fucking reset button. But yeah, Daryl did the driving to and from, and he likes to give lessons to the drivers around him.
He's a referee.
Yeah.
He's a referee, and he's got some flags to throw. And the coolest thing about this is just right off the bat. I mean, we're talking like, here's the fucking scenario. We're in the van. This is the van that I'm getting into after I've had a few beers. So I'm in a van and I'm laughing about, yeah, we're going to Faith No More. Seatbelts. All right. Daryl gets onto the road and takes a left onto the main road. And immediately, no turn signal.
Yeah. Yeah, he will literally lay on the horn for forever onto somebody just to make sure that they know that he knows that they fucked the fuck up.
10 yards for fucking no turn signal.
That's fucking right. Yeah.
And this was amazing because it wasn't just like every once in a while. It was like every time. And it wasn't just like, beep, beep, excuse me. It was like, fuck you. And so I knew, wow, we're going to get there. We're going to get to fucking, we're going to get to Detroit. And man, we got there. We got fucking... our buddy there got us in line.
Yep, Mike Rowland.
Fucking rock.
Pat Hoban, comedian from Michigan. Thank you guys.
Got in and rocked it.
Yep. But yeah, and on the way home, we got to listen to some Daryl stuff, some Volmox, some Farting Corpse tapes. The guy loves to rock the tapes. Still in the cassette mode. Man, that shit's pretty fucking cool, man.
Fuck yeah.
As far as noise stuff goes. Hopefully, next time we go up to Michigan, we'll check out this Michigan Underground that's there in Detroit. I don't know the exact address, but they got like a whole like art installation kind of thing going on there with noise acts and we missed a show right after the Faith No More show. It's not that night, but the 9th of May, Daryl did play a show with Farting Corpse.
Harsh Fest.
Yeah, they played Harsh Fest. We missed it because we were on a boat, and goddamn it, we needed a fucking break from fucking rolling around.
Holy shit. Yeah, that was like one of those trips where you have, like, I finally, after seeing Faith No More, started feeling better. That second night at Detroit, I think that was my problem there, is I had some beers and I wasn't feeling good. And ended up, you know, the next night, you know, the next day waking up feeling pretty good. I was like, all right, cool, let's do it. Let's get on a boat. I'm excited. I learned my Lonely Island song. I'm going to fucking play them on a boat. I'm going to kiss the guitar. I was there by myself. I was like, I'm on a boat, motherfucker.
Well, it's not going to be as awesome, but I did pick up a ticket to see Faith No More in North Carolina. And
whoa,
who's opening for this, for Faith No More there?
Refused. From Sweden. Yes. And in my mind, that is something that I really need to figure out how to get a ticket to and get to. Find, you know, because that, dude, Refused is one of those bands that, like, when that came out, I was actually into that. You know,
yeah, I remember them. He's like a very, they're kind of like a little bit of Dillinger Escape Plan to me. They cool. seem like that a little bit.
I don't know. I just remember what, I think it was a couple years later though, that like it, their last album, it was
what's the album? Something about Punk to Come.
Yeah. It's The Shape of Punk to Come.
Shape
was
of
like
Punk
their,
to Come.
The quintessential release. It's a later thing. They'd done,
but that's the one I remember
works.
Hearing.
I have their discography, but their last record was like the one that really got me into them. And then after, you know, a couple years and then some friends with the internet, I was able to get exposed to more Refused. But man, they're fucking awesome. And I guess they're back. There's a documentary called Refused is Fucking Dead that kind of like, they chronicle the, you know, the last little part of their thing and how the band broke up and everything. And their last show was actually in Harrisonburg, Virginia, in
really?
A basement. Yeah. And the cops came and shut the show down, and the kids just kept singing.
Yeah, I believe they've recently played Jimmy Fallon's show.
That's fucking cool. Refused is back, dude. Yeah. And that's really appropriate, you know, the way I look at that. That's just, that made so much fucking sense to me, and that seemed like...
That they're opening for Faith No More?
Absolutely. Yeah. It's the exact same kind of thing. It's like a sleeping giant that awakens and just fucking like... Because, you know, say what you want about any genre music or any bands that you're into or whatever. You got to respect people who don't give a fuck about what you're thinking that they are. Because who gives a fuck what you think? it's not about you. It's about them. And then it's about you dealing with that and learning from it. And but for real, don't be silly.
It's not what I'm saying. We're about to say isn't official, but it seems obvious to me that Fit No More started this tour, the shows that we went to. And they're pretty small, especially the one in Chicago, extremely small place. And then when we saw them in Detroit, the Fillmore, it's a larger size club. And these shows sold out so quickly, I think it seemed obvious to them that they needed to play larger venues. But those shows are already on record. I think that those shows surprised them how fast they sold out. I haven't heard them say that, but it seems obvious that I think that surprised them. And so they came back with another leg of that tour. And now they're playing Texas. They're going to play this show in Raleigh, North Carolina. They're playing a huge place in Boston. They're even playing fucking Madison Square Garden in August. That's insane that Faith No More is that big now.
What's the capacity there? Like 9,000?
Oh, I don't know. That 10, place 000? Is fucking massive. But yeah, for that, for this newer leg of the tour, for the stadium, I would call it.
Yeah.
Amphitheaters. Now they're going to they're bringing Refused with them.
Which is going to be great because they're great band. Like, they're hardcore music in its truest sense. They're bringing in all kind of different influences and all kind of different time signatures and genre into their music. Like, I always turned them on, or I turned my friends on to them that were musicians by saying they're kind of like hardcore jazz.
Yeah, I meant to listen to those guys on the way home with
you. If you're into jazz music and you're into the spirit of music that's not, you can't wrap your head right around it, and it takes you into different like rooms and emotions of yourself, and kind of like puts up a weird mirror that you didn't know that you could look into and see, you know, what's going on. Like, I don't know, I just, yeah,
the things you're saying actually reminds me of the album Calculating Infinity by Dillinger Escape Plan, and that's what I think Refused was like.
That's almost, a lot of that stuff's more grindy though.
We're splitting hairs kind of.
No, I agree with what you're saying. It's, I can totally
sort of, so that's like, I think they're very similar.
Absolutely. Like, I would 100% say that I get what you're saying about that record, because that is exactly how that one is.
Yeah.
Those guys are probably just working based on numbers. They're like, all right, we're going to do something 13-3, 17-40, and a 2. And then they fucking like hammer some shit out.
Yeah, over my head.
Well, you know, 2 is dun dun. And,
I know 2-2. I know 4-4. 5,
6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. That's 20.
Okay.
You know, so.
I thought you were talking about time signatures that are fucking crazy.
Well, no, I mean, that would be crazy if you put all those together, because it would be like...
Ladies and gentlemen, Sean.
Sorry, guys.
Well, yeah, you're going to... I assume you're coming with me. I've already got a ticket, so I'm already going.
Yeah, we'll see what happens. It's all very...
Sean, get in the fucking van.
You know...
So we have a little bit of a sequel coming up where we get to see Faith No More one more time on a different leg of the tour. Maybe they'll start playing more of the new album, because in Chicago I think they only played 3 songs off the new one, and in Detroit they played 4. So they're still not playing a lot of these songs live. Although I will take that back, in California somewhere, Santa Ana, I think they played the new album from front to back live. And that the whole show, that is on YouTube. And I'll put a link in the description. Hopefully that link stays. You know, sometimes these shows go. But I'm actually going to rip that one down to MP3s and keep it, because it's really cool that they played the whole album from front to back. The one other time that Faith No More did something like that is not too long ago in Santiago, Chile. They brought Trace Bruins, who was the guitarist on King for a Day, and played that album from front to back.
Oh, cool.
And it sounds so fucking good.
Awesome.
So
cool. So yeah, Shape to Punk, the Shape of Punk to Come.
The Shape of Punk to Come by Refused.
That's their 1997 release.
Yep.
I don't know if they've got anything new. They've got,
you know what? I'll drop just a bit of it right here. Not the whole song, obviously, but just a snippet, just so you know what we're talking about right here.
Yeah!
That's a little bit off of The Shape of Punk to Come.
I can't remember what the fucking first time I heard it. It was like it's like 14 years old. It's like
If I recall the video, they're playing an empty amphitheater in the song that I'm going to play. It's fucking rad fucking song.
Oh, you got a specific song.
I do have a specific song in mind. I can't remember the name of it.
Oh, I stole
I stole that.
I was like, this is the song. That's what you just listened to.
You know what? Refused. Fucking awesome. They're opening for Faith No More throughout the second leg of the tour. The amphitheater's there. They're going to be playing Texas. Raleigh, North Carolina, where I will be. They're going to be playing Boston and New York City. I think a couple more dates than that, I believe. Twice in Texas, actually.
Cool. Sol Invictus. Check out the new record. It's out now.
Yeah, Sol Invictus by Faith No More. Fucking A. Pick it up on vinyl, goddammit. Because if you pick it up on vinyl at like somewhere like Amazon, they'll give you the MP3s for free.
I've got the Shape of Punk to Come in vinyl wrapped up with the documentary. I bought it at a, you know how record stores kind of dried up like a couple years back? I got it for like $20, and I was so excited. I was like, dude, I'm never going to take it out. You know, it's still like, and it's laminate bullshit.
All right, so what, you got anything else you want to talk about? Nothing specific? Well,
I don't know.
Okay, well, I've been playing a video game, and it came out a year and a half ago, but it was re-released for the PlayStation 4, and now it's been re-released for the PC. I don't have a very good gaming PC. But I do have a PlayStation 4, and so I was replaying Grand Theft Auto 5. And, yeah, I'm one of those people who have to do every single goddamn thing. And this game, at this point, I've beaten it. But now I'm going through and I'm picking up, trying to find all the letters. I'm trying to find all the pieces of the spaceship. I'm going through and doing the online stuff and getting through the levels to get all the trophies. I'm a trophy whore on the PlayStation Network. All right, do you have any experience playing Grand Theft Auto 5?
No, but see, that's a good question. That sounds like a loaded question. No, I haven't played any of it, but I watched you play it, and they show tits in it. So that, to me, I was like, I'm seeing, like, tits.
Yes, in a video game.
And I remember being, like,
you can get a lap dance.
I remember being, like, a really young boy thinking, like, man, why can't they have, like, naked ladies in the video games, you know? Because there was, like, a couple, like... There was like one or two like Super Nintendo games or like...
Now, throughout history, there has always been, especially on PC and even like throughout some on Atari, there's always been a subculture of video games that do have tits and ass and dick and pussy and whatever.
Oh, I missed all that shit.
It just surprised me
in a game. I was like, whoa, you're playing a game that kids can buy at the store and there's titties in it?
Leisure Suit Larry. Custer's Revenge on Atari.
I feel like I played
Custer's Revenge on Atari is like a Kablam. Kablam being a game where you're at the bottom trying to collect bombs.
Uh-huh.
Whereas Custer's Revenge, at the top of the screen is a guy jerking off and sperm is shooting down and you got to catch it in like a vagina or something stupid like that.
I've seen stupid games
like
that.
This is old Atari 2600 game.
I've seen shit like that. What the fuck was that game? There's some stupid name of like Street Fuckers was one of them.
And of course, if you're the person who likes emulating video games, there's endless amounts of ROM hacks where Mario's naked or naked Super Punch Out.
No. Yeah, shit like that. But I'm. Okay. I stand corrected
yeah, like,
by the video
but,
game.
But legitimately, yeah, we're at a point now where there is nudity.
He can't play in 20.
Yeah, Grand Theft Auto 5. Is clearly a runaway success. It's M-rated, and yes, you can go into a strip club and get full lap dances.
Well, I mean, I knew I've got an experience with some of the older games. I played Grand Theft Auto San Andreas. I think I beat Vice City as far as I could. That was actually cool because my buddy let me borrow a PlayStation 2 and Vice City, and in 1 week, I beat 50% of the entire game, and I was in a mission, and the game like clipped out and stopped. And that's where it would always load, and it would never work.
Oh, and this was in San Andreas?
It was in Vice City.
Ah, Vice City.
San Andreas, couldn't get past a couple stupid missions. Yeah, I don't like those little tedious
things. I've never beaten San Andreas or Vice City, but I have beaten Grand Theft Auto 3, 4, and 5.
Well, I've just recently acquired a 360, and I have Grand Theft Auto 4.
Grand Theft Auto 4.
This is with the Russian guy.
Awesome. Oh, it's so fucking.
And
good.
I approach these games. I'm not really like a gamer per se. I like doing it when I have a little bit of time here and there.
So I don't know when you're going to have time to play anything. You've got a huge box of amazing games here, but you started with Skyrim. Now, Skyrim is amazing. That's not the point. That's not the point I'm saying. You started with Skyrim. Skyrim
is going
to take you 160 hours to finish.
Yeah, and I'm already...
That game does not fuck around.
Yeah, I'm already 10 hours in. I'm fine.
It's amazing. And I haven't beaten it. I only put like 30-some-odd hours into it, and I got kind of messed up and lost my save on the 360. And mostly, I only play stuff on PlayStation now, to be honest. PlayStation 3, PlayStation 4, PlayStation Vita.
The thing that really hurt my feelings about
nostalgia.
Skyrim
By the way, I'm Nostalgia Factor on there, in case you guys send me a friend request. I don't give a shit. I'll play video games with you. But I'm Nostalgia Factor, just like this Nostalgia Factor podcast. I'm on the PlayStation Network, and I don't play on fucking Xboxes anymore. I mostly just play on PlayStations.
Well, I do Xbox offline, and this Skyrim, like, I created a cool name for my guy and everything. And
what's
I, like,
his name?
Well, here's the problem. Like, his name was Nargor Snuffwolf.
Nargor Snuffwolf.
And all the letters were like different. I like pulled out different alphabets to put the other letters in.
Oh yeah,
so it was super
total,
rad.
Total German
then,
black metal.
Yeah, it was just gnarly.
Beast of Norway.
He's a Nord, and he's all like fucked up. He's got white eyes and like a blonde mohawk that's like over to one side.
I notice he's got the helmet with the horns that go down.
Yeah, that's the only helmet
total
I could find.
Fucking Danzig looking thing.
Yeah, it's cool. He's Narnar. Yeah. But now, or at some point in the game, I messed up, and his name is Prisoner, and so he's just called Prisoner now. I don't know if you can change his name.
I don't know.
That was the default name, and it named him that.
I always try to call my characters Dr. Doom, or Nostalgia, if whatever. But Dr. Doom's what I usually try to roll with. And I just created a Grand Theft Auto online character named Dr. Doom, and I'll be fucking damned. They had the metal mask for Dr. Doom, and I'm wearing it, and it's fucking awesome.
Amazing.
I haven't found, like, a green hoodie yet, but I'm sure I'll find a green hoodie to go with my metal mask, and I'll be fucking Dr. Doom in there.
My character in San Andreas is what's his name, Daryl?
Character, CJ?
CJ. Oh, it's CJ. Yeah, it's CJ. He's got a blonde mohawk, and he's wearing a Jason mask.
Nice.
It's I got the Jason mask, and he's like, he walks around and fucking.
You gotta
red.
Love the customization of those video games.
All these
yeah, I've
ones,
been
yeah.
playing
Great.
Grand Theft Auto 5 again on the PlayStation 4. I've finished all the story missions, 69 out of 69. I'm at a 76% completion because there's things I haven't found yet to complete it. And I'm still trying to find the spaceship parts. I'm still trying to find the letters to solve some mystery to complete that. But I'm trying to go for the 100% completion. But what's the most striking aspect of Grand Theft Auto 5 is you don't play as one character. You play as three, and you can hold down on the D-pad, and then you can switch between one of these three characters. And beyond, one of the best video game characters ever is Trevor from fucking Grand Theft Auto 5. And some of the most hilarious moments that happen is when you switch between characters, you don't know what they're doing. They're not going to be in some like, oh, they're at their house. Sometimes they're at their house. Sometimes they're fucking being chased by the cops, and you all of a sudden are just in the middle of being chased by the cops. But the funniest one,
and they talk. They speak their own mind accordingly.
They speak their own mind. Trevor will change the radio on you. So, like, you can choose which radio station you listen to, but Trevor better like it. Because most of the time, Trevor will switch it back to the fucking punk station. But
nice.
the best, funniest moments in this game is you switch to Trevor, and he'll, like, have somebody tied to a pole on the pier where the fucking water's going to come in, and he'll just fucking leave them there. Or he's suddenly behind these two guys riding a bicycle, and he's like, oh, you think you're so fucking great riding bicycles, and you have the option of letting them go, but you know what you're going to do. You're going to fucking run them over on their fucking bikes. But the funniest one that I found, I switched to Trevor, it goes down into him, and there he is on the beach, and he's standing over this couple who's laying on the beach suntanning as a couple, and he's leaning over them with his face just really close to him and goes, I just want to be held. That's not creepy. And they get up and run away from him. And you can choose to kill him as they run away from you, but it's like, I'll just let them live with that fucked up memory.
Wow, dude.
Leaning over someone who's sleeping. I just want to be held.
Yeah, these games are getting really fun.
I
like the way that they... Like, even with the Skyrim game, it's like you create your own destiny, and mine got fucked real quick, because I'm like the guy, you know, in Legend of Zelda, I was like, how do I kill this chicken? You know, I'm going to whack the chicken. How many times does it take to kill a chicken in Zelda?
You never get to.
You can't kill the
chicken.
You can't.
You just over and over and over.
It just bounces.
It just balks at you and runs. And sometimes I can think it can hurt you.
It can peck you back after like three hits. It can get mad and peck you.
In the newer Zelda games, you can pick the chicken up, and then if you jump off a cliff while holding the chicken, you'll float.
Yeah, they do that. I think they started doing that on the Game Boy one.
Yeah, and
but you could only do it off the cliff going downward like
that. Because technically in Zelda, you can't jump, but if you kind of go off the ends of a cliff, you kind of jump off of it. But if you're holding the chicken, you'll glide down, which is a lot safer.
Yeah, but this particular thing, like when I did that, all of a sudden all these dudes got pissed. And then when they got pissed, I fought them. And then when I killed them, they got really pissed. So all of a sudden, I'm going in this town, and like the people that I'm supposed to talk to for my mission are attacking me, and I'm trying to be like, start a conversation with them. It's like bloodthirsty madness. There's seven or eight guys trying to fuck me over.
Yeah, and once you start killing the people in the towns in that game, you get marked, and basically throughout the rest of the game, you'll be an outcast.
What's fun though about it is that like if you
this
run
is
away,
Skyrim we're talking
if
about.
You run away as fast as you can. You can literally go to another town and pay the fine for your bounty for the crimes you did in the other town.
Yeah.
And they're not aggressive because they didn't watch you do the crime. They're just like, oh, you're a wanted man. And you're like, okay, cool. Now I'm a Thane, so the dude doesn't do shit to me. I'm like, fuck you, I'm Thane. He's like, cool, whatever.
No, I'm really looking forward to doing the online heists that have been released for Grand Theft Auto V. The heists that are within the game were so fucking fun. We took down a jewelry store. We broke into the, it's called FIB in the game, but it's basically the FBI headquarters there in basically Los Angeles.
So is that comparable to the latter or to the last couple games?
It is, but it's just
the
next.
Is it just...
It's very comparable to Grand Theft Auto 4. It's extremely like the gameplay is extremely similar. But it did add things like heists and you choosing how you're going to do the heist and you choosing like who your crew is going to be. Like, do I want to hire this driver, or this driver? And each of those, like, one could be better at it, but he's going to want a higher cut. So if you get through, you're going to make less money, but it'd be easier to get through if
you
choose.
So you get a sketchy
dude to do it. You get gunmen. And some of the really cool Easter eggs within Grand Theft Auto 5 is some of those guys you get to pick to go on the crew with you are dudes that were in Grand Theft Auto 4.
Oh, cool, you get the Russian guy to come help you.
No, not the Russian guy. The Russian guy does make a small little cameo in Grand Theft Auto 5 in Grand Theft Auto Online. The way Grand Theft Auto Online player creation works, you don't just get to choose what your face and shit looks like. You choose who your parents are. And so, I know, it's really weird. So you choose who your mom is, and then you choose, you get to choose 20 different dudes and 20 different women to choose who your parents were, and one of the dudes is Nico from Grand Theft Auto 4.
Nico, not Dimitri. Dimitri's his cousin or something.
Yeah, Dimitri's his cousin who works at the cab company
or
whatever.
He's like, can you come pick me up?
Yeah, and...
See, I've seen people play Grand Theft 4, but I've never
I played the living shit out of Grand Theft Auto 4.
I
actually,
video games
I played that game in a way to, like, literally, if anybody called me and said, pick me up, you can choose to ignore it and do whatever, but I always picked them up, and it would drive you crazy, but you'd like win trophies and shit for that. And I'm the kind of person that's like, there's a trophy for doing that. I got to do it.
Yeah. I got acquainted with Far Cry 4 on the Faith No More trip. I wasn't feeling well, so, you know, I hung it loose while Jeff was at work, and I played Far Cry 4.
Well, Jeff being the guy whose house we stayed at while we were up in Michigan.
Thanks, dude.
That Great new house on Zucky Lake. Got a boat out there. Dude's fucking awesome.
I think it's Zucky. It's Zucky Lake.
I keep calling it Zucky, don't I?
Yeah. It's Zucky Lake.
Zucky.
Good pizza.
Yeah. I think it's like famous. Their t-shirts are famous. Sometimes famous people are wearing their fucking...
Let's go to Michigan to a little lake. Dude, it's funny. Okay, so we live in Virginia. I live in Floyd, Virginia. There's a lot of dirt roads around here. And in Michigan, they have dirt roads too. The speed limit up there on the dirt roads is 55.
I believe so, yeah.
The speed limit down here is like
45, but it'd be news to me if it was anything.
It's like 25 or 35 tops, like on a dirt road, because it's unsafe. Like, but here you live in the mountains. So you've got curves and ups and rounds.
Yeah,
and,
right.
And switchbacks and all these things. It's like sometimes you can only go 5 miles an hour and you got to hug the outside or you're going to get a head-on collision every time you try to leave your house.
The major difference between the roads here in Virginia and in Michigan.
Of dirt roads up there.
There are shitloads of dirt roads. The difference is in Michigan, there's usually a direct route to go anywhere you want to go. If you want to go to Lansing, to Detroit, you take 96. I mean, you might have a little bit here and there, but in Virginia, you got to go around fucking mountains, man. So nothing is a direct route. Like, by the way, the crow flies, it's a pretty short distance between where I live and where my parents live. But they live up in the fucking mountains, which means the roads have got to go all the way around over to here.
It's actually just like Skyrim, where I live. Like, I was actually thinking about that. I was like, cool, like, I'm literally climbing up the top of a mountain. I'm going to, like, stand at the edge and look down at the valley below and shit.
Yeah.
But I have to walk all the way around a fucking mountain because the thing I want to do is on the other fucking side. So I have to walk like 8 miles this way and around and up and over. Yeah, it's all.
Yeah, Grand Theft Auto has this problem with mountains as well. The good news is that there are fucking helicopters and planes in Grand Theft Auto 5.
Awesome.
But there are huge, huge, gorgeous mountains. And you can go up to the top of the mountains and do mountain biking or fucking dirt biking.
Hang gliding.
You can do hang gliding. Well, I don't know if you can do hang gliding.
That's Far Cry
that's 4. That's Far Cry 4. You can do hang gliding.
And but, you have a fucking... A squirrel suit.
You can do base jumping and shit.
In Far Cry, you have like a.
Yeah, go ahead and talk about Far Cry 4. What was your impressions of that, really?
I really didn't have too much more than just. I started getting the gameplay after I played it for a couple hours. I just started running around in just like full blown chaos mode. I was like, I got a shitty gun. Give me like the shittiest gun. So I had like a six shooter and a knife, and I went out and just fucking like shot animals and.
Were you doing the missions, or you were just doing, like, chaos?
Just chaos, like, getting on boats and, like, getting on, you know, just learning where things were and what things did. And my mission became, after a while, I realized that I could turn off the signal for the propaganda over the loudspeaker at the towers.
Oh, yeah.
So I started climbing towers and pulling the plug on the communications.
And that opens up the map.
Yeah, so I fucking, in like 3 hours, I opened up like a ton of the map. And in between those places, there's danger and there's shit happening to me. So
at any given time, you cannot go from point A to point B in Far Cry 4 without running into a fuck ton of shit.
And I had the shittiest gun, and which is hilarious because... I had these guys who later after they got back to the place, still like fucking vegging out like directly in the core of my shit that I've been doing. And they're watching me heckling and they have this like banter like, Jesus Christ, this is this guy's fucking video game shit. We ought to record this and never watch it. Like, this sucks. And I'm like, what do you mean? This is awesome. I'm like MacGyver out here. I fucking like punch wolves and shit. One punch and they're dead.
Yeah, you're using like just a pistol.
I was using a six shooter and a fucking knife and like some bait.
Yeah.
And I was very. Well,
but that's the beautiful thing about that game is you can play it however the fuck you want.
Oh, I played it like
that. But you were playing it like hard on yourself. Like, you do realize there are flamethrowers and fucking bombs and machine guns.
And I was also playing it like walk straight to the nearest cliff and just jump straight down off the cliff and maybe I'll land and get hurt and maybe I won't. But I got the fuck down that mountain real fast and real badass about it. And then the fucking...
Not using any of the, like, the hypodermic needles you can use to heal yourself. Fuck none that of that shit. No, yeah, fuck it.
You know what I use? I use bait, motherfucker. I cut my fucking... I'd kill something, I'd take the bait, and then I'd wait till there were, like, some dudes hanging around near a car talking, and I'd throw some bait, and then I'd throw some bait near
the
bait. Let
the leopards kill the dudes.
Well, no, what I would do is I would instigate a fight between a leopard and a bear because I'd throw two different pieces of bait in, like, two places that were generally close.
Right.
And then the bear attack would happen on the leopard, and the fucking people would be there. And I would just literally watch those people get torn apart by animals rather than kill them. So I'd say the bait's pretty cool. I used a knife. I got the bait. I instigated an animal attack in Far Cry 4.
Yeah, one thing that's fun to do with the bait is to throw down some plastic explosive, then throw down bait, and then stand back like a barrel run up to it, and you just fucking detonate that cocksucker.
Here's a twist. Here's a tweak on that. You throw it, you throw the plastic explosive, because at some point in time I acquired some plastic explosive.
Right.
Then I ended up starting to do, and this may have been at your house on your profile after you had beaten the game.
No, I
can't remember here or there. Either way, I was doing things like if there was an elephant that was in the town, or a rhino or something, I would put plastic explosive on them and then call bait, and then I'd get animals to attack the animal that had...
Did you say you put plastic explosive on a rhino?
Yeah.
That's brazen.
You, like, throw it and stick it to the rhino, and then you call, like, you throw some bait, and then something will come and attack the rhino, and then when those things are fighting, then you blow up the rhino, and then you have a pile of animals going, oh, it's amazing. Throw C4 on the animals.
Yep. So I'd say one other thing that we got into on this trip before we head out is I just want to give a shout out to Mr. Metokur.
Oh, Jesus. And Nick Bates.
Yes. Mr. Metokur used to be the internet aristocrat. And the internet aristocrat took down a lot of like Gamergate fuckers and what have you. And I don't really want to get involved with all that, but he had such a fucking hilarious... way of putting it, and with the insight that he had on it, and basically what Mr. Metokur does these days
is a true cynic.
He's a total cynic, and he's a fucker buster. If you're a fucker out there on the internet and
oh,
you're doing
great.
Fucker bullshit, and Perfect. You were and you're a total dick, you bet, and you're doing this stuff on the internet, Mr. Metokur will find you, and he will take you the fuck down. He'll take you down where you and your whole fucking crew of people who are just like you will cry and have such a bad time, and you'll try to get his videos taken down, and it'll be so sad for you, and you'll be so butthurt, but he will fuck your ass up. Mr. Metokur, you kick ass, sir.
Fuck yes, sir.
So, just want to give a shout out. I don't want to talk about what Mr. Metokur talks about, but, I hold him in high regard. Look him up here on YouTube, or he's on Twitter, but mostly it's YouTube videos. It's called Mr. Metokur, or you could look up Internet Aristocrat. And I just wanted to give a shout out to him. I do not want to get into his topics.
No. I was gonna just tell the audience that at this point in time, thus far throughout the podcast, I've already referenced two things that I've learned specifically from this fellow.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, like so, other
no,
what
you
have
just
you.
I was gonna just say, like, for fun, once you listen to Metokur, go back and listen, and then you'll hear those things, and then you can actually fully understand some certain little name drop things. Anyhow,
yeah, like I say, I don't want to get into his topics, but I definitely want to say that that's something I've been getting into big time lately is the Internet Aristocrat and the Mr. Metokur videos. I like to listen to them while I'm doing my doing things at work, and I just really enjoy them. And so check them out if you feel like it. All right. Well, next time we were a little bit unprepared. We've been, dealing with travel and dealing with Sean's been recording with other bands and stuff. So
we've been doing all kinds of different things.
When we do this show, we want to be a little bit more prepared and come up with a little some of these segments we've got ideas for. We didn't have any of that ready for today, but by God, we had to talk about this Faith No More trip.
And I'm glad we did.
But yeah, next time we'll be talking about the new Mad Max film.
Oh God, I can't wait for that.
Totally trip. Badass. But yeah, for Nostalgia Factor. I'm Duane.
Shaun of the Dead.
Yep, Shaun of the Dead. And catch us on YouTube. Catch us on Twitter. Catch us on Facebook. Catch us on Instagram. Catch us on Vine, oddly enough. I'm on Vine.
Catch us in your mouth.
Tumblr. We're on there, too. So, check it out. Nostalgia Factor, Nostalgia Factor, Nostalgia Factor. Late.